there was
however, we do find
when artificially nesting was not common, and it was difficult to make out if small insects were coming during the night. So many religious thoughts were that to eat during good daylight. So you know at least what you're eating and you're not hanging. It has nothing much to do with health.
But we find that all over the world people normally tend to eat in the evening.
Yeah, because you know, all these artificial lighting is in the last century or so. Prior to that, say 200 years ago, everybody had to eat in the day, right? No choice. And better to know what you're eating rather than eating. This is undoubtedly an extremely important question. Shall I stay to talk about it now? Okay. Human mind is a part of the human body. That is to say, mind is a function of the brain, and brain is a function of part of the human body. And therefore, mind cannot be separated from the body. They are so closely interrelated. Mind will affect the body and the body will affect the mind because it is my body itself is mind. However, there is no part of the human body which is not under control of the human brain. No part, right from the hair on the head to the tip of our nails, everything is controlled by the brain. And brain keeps on sending positive and negative influences to every part of the body, making the function better and making the function less. This is mainly because the body functions require to be modified. For example, we need to have better digestion when the food is there, and the digestive juices need not be secreted when there is no food there. So the intestines will work and not work by the according to the need, and that controls it entirely in the brain. We will need to have the leg muscles work when you want to walk, and you want to sleep, they will be relaxed. So what is the need of that moment is decided by the brain, and the entire body is under control of brain. But sometimes it can happen that the brain gets deceived, shall we say. For example, the brain is, as I said some time back, is tuned to secrete acid at a certain time, and we don't eat at that time. Or the brain is used to sleep at a certain time, and we don't sleep at that time. And whatever our daily day's timetable is, if we keep on upsetting it, then the brain gets confused. The time to sleep, the time to get up, the time to eat, the time to do, let's say, time to do exercise. Supposing if I say that every day at 7 o'clock in the morning I'm going to do exercise, then a few minutes before that, the brain starts sending impulses to the muscles so that the muscles will now become active enough to do the exercise. And you do exercise at a totally different time, the body muscles are not ready for it. Then they might get sprained, or they might rupture, or they might get whatever might happen. So your entire day's routine should be as strictly followed with respect to time as it is possible. Then the brain and the body will work accordingly, properly. What comes in the way of brain function is mostly tension, anxiety, and thought processes of different types which will come in the way of brain function. For example, if a person is worried about something, he might find it very difficult to get sleep. Maybe once he sleeps, he is alright, but he will not get sleep at his usual time if the thought processes are worrying him. Now, if he doesn't sleep at the proper time, then the functions which should have been rested at that time are not rested. And therefore then aches and pains will come, muscles will be not working properly, and every function of the body, including the digestion, juices, excretion, they are not well managed. And therefore, the most important thing for the brain to function well would be to overcome anxiety. How does one overcome anxiety? Firstly, simply by asking one's own mind, what am I anxious about? Because somebody else asks you, your first defense would be, I'm not worried about it. Every person's standard answer will be, I am not worried about anything. But that is not true. There is no human being on the surface of this earth who has no worries. So you answer yourself from that, what is your anxiety? And then you say, what was your expectation and what was the reality? The gap between expectation and reality generates anxiety. Reality is reality, you cannot change it. But expectations are dependent upon the values which we have generated and what we think is ideal. For example, maybe a value that has been generated from our childhood is that everybody must speak the truth. And therefore that value is generated, and you come across somebody who is not speaking the truth, then there is a gap between expectation and reality. Then you get upset, then you get angry, then you get worried, then you don't know how to rely on this person. So it will entirely depend upon your values and the realities that there may be there. And therefore you would say that the values which I have nurtured in me have been processed so during my childhood by my parents, by my teachers, by my colleagues, by what I think is right. But that may not be the case with everybody. And the most important value which is natural, instinctive, is do what makes you survive. So if you think at that time that speaking an untruth, you might survive and you may not be punished, the first reaction will speak the truth. And only by process of culture and upbringing and values that you may resist that temptation. And therefore our expectations from others may not be according to the values that we have. So we will have lots of tensions which will come over and over. So you apply your mind by saying, okay, what in my life, what am I expecting and in what way is different from the reality that I have just now watched, and the reason is that somebody else's values are different from mine. This is bound to be the case. Everybody has a different value system, and therefore I can have values for my own improvement, but I cannot expect values from others. If you accept that, all the anxiety will go. That is the whole principle of keeping the mind at peace.
And how does that get related to the physiology?
Well, supposing if I find that there is a gap between my expectation and reality, then my first reaction would be to try and change that reality, because that must come up to my expectation. That is obviously not possible. It is only possible in extremely few instances that you can change the reality. But you cannot change everybody else's mind, or you cannot do anything. Then you will get angry, you will get frustrated, and all that will get reflected onto your own body. And that will result in you increasing your blood pressure, increasing your pulse rate, stopping your digestion, coming in the way of your sleep. Something that will prepare you for a fight and flight response. And that fight and flight response will act every part of your body and will prepare you for a fight, but there is nothing to fight about. For example, let us say a student is appearing for the examination and suddenly finds that the question is very difficult. Now with whom can he fight? He can't fight with the question, he can't fight with the examiner, he can't fight, but the body has produced all those reactions. Or suddenly somebody goes and finds that the cost of the business has gone up. Cost of sugar is so much, so suddenly doubled. Then wholesome is white, but the reaction is there. And that will produce all sorts of illnesses which are related to stress. Also, stress results into many other things. For example, if you are worried and you are thinking about something else, you are prone to accidents. You are prone to making mistakes. You are prone to making wrong errors in judgment. And then repent later on, but there is no use. One of the mistakes done commonly is that teachers may get angry with students, or mothers might get angry with their children, and feel that I did it to improve him. This is the biggest mistake a person can do. By getting angry and by punishing somebody, you cannot improve others. That is totally out of it. That way, imprisonment and life sentences and even death sentences have been there for centuries, but nothing has happened. I mean, people will still keep on doing murder. This is because it is, if you want to improve anybody, let us say somebody makes a mistake in not doing a much of this rightly. Then, as a teacher, first you must go one step below what he understands. From there you start teaching him and seeing where was his error, what did he not understand, and then teach him. Then he will be able to do the right thing. By giving him a punishment, or by scolding him, or by hitting him, you cannot improve his mathematics. This is a mistake made. I have known teachers, even in those who teach, say let us say swimming. If somebody doesn't know swimming, punish the fellow by just pushing him to water. That's a very long thing to do. How will he learn by doing that process? It is totally wrong. If a boy has fear of getting into water, first thing to do is to get rid of his fear by showing him that, see, I am now getting into water, nothing is happening to me. And so many people are swimming and nothing is happening to me. Come with me. I will say to it that if you have any problem, I will take you out. If that fear goes, they don't need to start learning, otherwise they won't. There are many who are frightened of driving. That's because either they have seen or experienced or something that a car can have an accident. But that is an accident. It's really something which will happen only very occasionally. So many people, thousands of people are driving on the road every day and accidents don't occur. That has to be shown. And the truth must go, then only you can teach.
Basically, there is a gland which secretes.
You know, we have 27 hormones in our body, and all of them are meant for the defense. So, the moment there is a threat, they are all secreted. And they cause rise in blood pressure, rise in sugar, rise in pulse rate. They do all these things to prepare ourselves for that kind of a fight. And in sugar, as we have often said, out of the 27, only one hormone reduces blood sugar, that is insulin. 26 hormones increase in blood sugar. So one against 26, sugar is bound to rise.
So the real effective way is to only control your stress.
Only effective to control your stress. And how can you control the rest of the 26 hormones? By reducing stress. And by reducing stress, we mean understand what is it that is giving you stress and what is it that you expected and that is not happening. Again, the same thing, that your expectation and reality, there was a gap. That expectation can begin with yourself. You might say that only yesterday, whatever I read, I remembered it. But today I have read it twice. This is not right. But the fact is that you have read it twice today to remember. So what can you do about it? There will be many who would say that there was a time when I once heard or read, I remember it all my life. And today I don't remember it. It's going to happen. This is change. Life would change. Our brain capacity, our ability to work, everything. Every single day we will age. This is a fact. This is the reality.
What are the other effects of stress on the body apart from sugar?
Sure, of insulin.
Mm-hmm. Stress.
There is no part of human body which is not affected by stress. Because of all these hormones which are secreted, plus the sympathetic nervous system, it gets activated. On the brain, for example, it will take away your ability to recall. You know, the very classical story of Ali Baba and his brother Qasim. Now, Qasim went into that cave, and the stress that now the thieves are going to come, he could not remember the word season. Otherwise, it's a simple word, everybody knows it. And if the stress is there, you cannot recall. You may know it, you cannot recall. This is the case with a very large number of students I know. I've dealt with some students over years and years and years. Good students, studious, knowing the subject. They have known, but at the time of exam, they cannot recall. This is also natural.
Is this for the flight or fight thing?
Yeah, what happens is, when you want to fight, then you don't want to keep your brain wanting to remember anything. You want to concentrate on the present fight right now. So you'll forget about whatever you
switch off a number of functions.
No, whatever you were in the past, you will not remember. But if you're not worried, if you're confident, you'll say that whatever the man is asking, I know it. So you will recall everything. And I always used to tell students who are going for examination that, see, examiner comes there just to have a cup of tea and eat a samosa and is not bothered about it, very casual. You have studied for 5 years. You're prepared. You know more than the examiner. Look at the examiner's eye and tell him that this is the fact. And he will not worry about it. Why should a boy get anxious about the examination? He has studied, he knows everything. And even if you were not to know one thing out of 100, it doesn't matter.
So, other than the brain, even?
Other than the brain, for example, if the blood pressure rises, then it can affect the arteries, then the person may have an involvement in the heart. And so many hormones are released. One of the most vital hormones released is cortisone. Now cortisone has many other advantages. The most greatest advantage of cortisone is that cortisone acts on the cells and releases many other chemicals which generate energy. But it comes in the way of defense. So supposing somebody has an injury, the wound healing will not occur. Or cortisone will come in the way, it will produce too much acid in the stomach. Patients may get ulcers. Or the bones may become brittle and therefore they will be easy, they will easily get a fracture. And from top to bottom, new cells will not be formed. And therefore all the growth will become stunted. So cortisone will be harmful if it keeps on happening again and again and again. And if the insulin is not produced adequately, because that's the only one hormone which will be suppressed, then body cannot produce energy. You will get tired, you will fatigue. You wake up tired. Now, after having slept for 6, 7, 8 hours, why should a person feel tired when he is waking up? But when he has stress for a period of time, the experience will be, my God, is it already 7 o'clock? I thought it was only middle of the night. But sleep is never complete. And so also digestion, so also every other function, immunity, everything will suffer because of stress.
So now, if one has to look at a regular medical checkup, what do you think one should do and how frequently?
Well, once in a year, if you have a physical check, just to check your blood pressure, heart, everything, that is adequate. Once in 3 years, if you have your blood and everything else checked up, and if something is wrong, it can be checked again after a year. There may be something which might require to be checked more often, like for example, somebody has diabetes and his blood sugar requires to be checked very often. There may be an occasional instance where blood sugar may be required to be checked 3-4 times a day. But otherwise, the person who has no complaints, carrying on his normal life, physical examination once a year is quite adequate, and once in 3 years, if you find something wrong, of course you can check it every year. If you find borderline blood sugar, check it every year. We don't want it to just keep on rising.
But this medical checkup would mean things like a stress test, a cardiogram, or
no? That is not required. A cardiogram once in 3 years.